Here we have Dr. D. Santanalakshmi to share his knowledge on membrane microencapsulation technology. Dr. Santanalakshmi is a faculty at the College of Pharmacy, Al Kitab University, Iraq. She obtained her PhD in chemistry from Anna University and got her postdoctoral experience from Kurin University and Kate, Japan. She was a visiting researcher at Tokyo Institute of Technology, Japan, IITM CNR, Italy, and University di Corona, Spain. She has also a prestigious Marie Curie International Incoming Fellowship. Her research interests are seaweed chemistry, material fabrication, food packaging, surface modification, and biomaterials. She has published several research and review articles in various reputed journals. We welcome Dr. D. Santanalakshmi to enlighten us on work on the topic of membrane and microencapsulation technology. Over to you, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Now it's clear.
Yeah, fine. Thank you. I think, is it moving? The slides are moving?
Yeah, ma'am. Yeah.
Fine. Okay. So good morning. First of all, I would like to thank this organizer for giving me a chance to share my experience, because first of all, I should inform you all that I'm basically native of Tanjore. I was born and brought up here, and so all my initial foundation, education, everything belongs to Tanjore. So whatever I am today, it's all because of my native place and my teachers, everybody. Till PG, I did my education in Tanjore. Then I moved to Anna University for my PhD. So first of all, I would like to share like probably a 10 minutes about the basic education I had here and how I take it further through national and international level. Then how I get interested in research, because basically I love history more than science. Till now, I love history. But due to my teacher, 7th standard teacher, she was doing some prism experiment, so I got interested. Then I was diverted towards science. So this is how I become. Otherwise, sure, I'll be a history. I want to do something on archaeology, but I shifted towards science because of my 7th standard teacher from St. Joseph's School, Dr. Josephine, Dr. and Mrs. But she's very good in science. So most of the cases, the teachers, the foundation, the primary and high school level teachers, who are the one who really brought us narrow down our area or to make interest, because basically I love history. But I shifted towards science because of my teacher. So most of the teachers, the primary level and high school teachers, are very crucial in deciding student future. So I am fortunate enough to be in science because of my teachers. So coming back to my education, I started my education in St. Joseph's Girls High Secondary School in Tanjore. It's in Pukkaratheru. This is what the building looks like. And till my 10th standard, I was in St. Joseph's. Then I moved to Sacred Heart Girls High Secondary School. That is another school. It's in close vicinity for my high secondary. I did my pure science. Then after my pure science, I obviously, because being in Tanjore that time, that is the only option is Kundabai Nachiyar Government Arts College for Women. There I took my BSc chemistry. I did my pure chemistry with physics and zoology as my ancillary. Then during my chemistry, I was more of involved then. My professors, my graduate professors, they themselves decided they were very sure that I'll do PG, because before that I don't have an idea I want to do PG. But during my BSc practical final exams, we used to get the invigilators from Sarfoji College, because they have a PG day. So that time she used to introduce me next year she's going to come to your college. Then after practical exam, I asked, ma'am, how do you know I will do PG? She said, yeah, we know you will do PG. So that's how they motivated. Without my knowledge, they said, I will do PG. Then I got admitted in Sarfoji College for my MSc chemistry. So I did my MSc chemistry there. From there, I was kind of doing I'll be in research. After my PG, I understand a bit more about research. Then I applied for some research position. That was an advertisement shown in our department notice board. So then I applied. I went to Bharathidasan University, Department of Chemistry. Then they conducted an interview. Then they said, yeah, you got selected, you come and join. So that's how I entered the research as a junior research fellow funded by UGC project. From there again I applied to Anna University. Again it's a Central Pollution Control Board project. There I shifted towards more of environmental chemistry, general chemistry to environmental chemistry. There I did some kind of metal removal and water, potable water production and industrial water effluents treatment. So from there I joined as a PhD in Anna University. And this slide more or less shows all my links so far, wherever I spend my time as a researcher or faculty or a PhD scholar. So from Bharathidas University, I shifted to Anna University, Department of Chemical Engineering, AC College of Technology with Professor Mohan. He is an eminent person in membrane technology. I joined PhD with him. And he is the one who will give kind of freedom. He said, okay, I want results. You explore on your own. Because this membrane lab, this specialized is on polymeric membrane, but the topic I choose is liquid membrane. Nobody literally knows other than the definition what is liquid membrane there. So that time he was telling Kishan, if you want to really do, I'll give you freedom, but I can't help you. You have to find on yourself. So I used to travel around India and went to several CSIR labs to take paper, to meet scientists, and I want to see their work. So that's how I developed everything on my own. Then my professor was very happy. Even if you don't get enough papers, you are introducing a new technique or new area to the lab. So, and with a little amount of papers, one or two papers, we went for the fellowship, because we need a fellowship. Without that, we can't do PhD. Especially when you need to cope up with your physical and mental pressure, you need to have a financial flow. Of course, we can't ask parents after doing PG, though they support, we don't feel, you know, happy about it. So I went for SRF interview. That is a senior research fellowships. After your PG, you are eligible to apply. If you score, I think it's a first class mark. If you have a paper and research experience, it's like added benefit. Then you have to write a proposal. So this is what I did. Then went to Delhi, CSIR New Delhi. We gave an interview. They asked mainly about your proposal. They want to check whether you are capable to explain your proposal. First of all, they need to check whether you wrote the proposal, whether really you know anything about your proposal. Because most of the cases, in some professors, they spoon feed like anything. They will, you know, they will help you in writing. But my professor is not that category. He said, you write and bring. I'll do final checkup. So they will be asking you to explain. There will be like 10 professors will be sitting, all experts all over India. Each one will ask you a question. How is it? What is the proposal? How far it's going to influence the Indian economy? That was the exact question they asked me. Because liquid membrane is a bit expensive, they said, okay, how it's going to support Indian economy? I said, because from seawater, we have a lot of gold. Though it's PPM level, it's a rich source. But we have to use the liquid membrane technology, but that is again expensive. Maybe if somebody is keen on working, they develop a technology, probably they can take it further. So these kind of questions they ask, then they give me senior research fellowship. That is for 3 years. It's quite enough for you to survive as a researcher, you can enjoy. Then slowly, then afterwards, I got a visiting research fellowship from Tokyo Institute of Technology. Again, is on chemical engineering department. There also, I worked on membrane technology for petrochemical effluent. From there, again, I come back to India. I joined as a research associate, again, funded by CSIR. Then in the meantime, I got a postdoc offer from Kurume University of Medicine. That is the southern part of Japan. They interested on paper membrane for radioactive effluent treatment. So because during my PhD also, I spent close to 1 year, 1 year in Baba Atomic Research Center. That's the radiochemistry division. I did part of my work there. So I was a little bit exposed to radiation, how to control, how to treat the effluent water. So I think that is the reason I got this Kurume University fellowship. I went there. Then again, I got some NRF funding from South Africa. I went to PE Technica. So then from Kurume University, again, I applied for some of the fellowship that I got, Kanagawa Institute of Technology. That is a northern part. It's in Tokyo exactly. There I did, I think, close to 3 years. I worked on supercritical fluid extraction. So slowly from membrane, I slightly shifted to paper membrane. Then in the Kanagawa Institute of Technology, I was closely working on chemical engineering work, that is supercritical fluid extraction. From there, I wrote a proposal for a Marie Curie Foundation to get an individual fund. They call it as an international incoming fellowships. I wrote a proposal and I choose Italy as my host because the professor is very good and the lab is very good, with Professor Drioli. I submitted the proposal after many rounds of, you know, they do, you know, some marking and other stuff. They said, yeah, your proposal scored more than 90 some marks, so we are ready to fund. then negotiation happened, then I come back to India, I applied for a visa, then that's how I landed in Institute on Membrane Technology, that is a CNR lab in Italy. During this Marie Curie program, I have a flexibility because I have my own fund. It's close to 1,70,000 euros for 2 years. So I can do any European lab I can choose. I can do part of the work. So that's how I went to FCT Portugal, Lisbon lab. There I worked with Professor Crespo on membrane technology for a few months. Then I come back to that, I finished. Then my professor offered another position in ITM. I did. Then the meantime, in Indian government is calling back the people from abroad. The CSIR invited me to join as a scientist. Tenure track position in CSMCR is in Gujarat. This lab, I started working more on seaweed chemistry, marine polysaccharide, and other things. After finishing the tenure track, I come back again. I went to Israel. It's a Ben Gurion University. It's a water research lab. There again, I went to work on fouling control membrane. And from there, I during the summer vacations, I used to go to University of Coruña. That's in Spain. It's like a southern part of Spain. They work on maximum food packaging, biopolymers, composites, gel, etc. So these pure chemistry to membrane, membrane to biological, and more of interdisciplinary work. And these logos are related, and these are very close to my heart because I spent enough time there. So coming back to the funding resources, whatever I get, the most of the thing, the CSIR. CSIR has given me SRF, extended SRF, RA. Three big fellowship. It is like boosting for me to do research, and it gave me like, yeah, everybody can do research because government is ready to support. This is like decades back, but now we have more number of fellowships. Government has introduced many things to support young researchers. Like they want people to come inside the research. They, instead of technology, raw science, the basic science is more important. So I should be very thankful to CSIR for providing, you know, fellowship. Then afterwards, I got funded from National Research Foundation from South Africa and MEX Fellowship from Japan and the UGC from Government of India and CPCB Government of India and Marie Curie Foundation, obviously. And the Marie Curie FP7 program, I was the one who got that. And IRACSIS, I'm in IRACSIS India. Marie Curie ambassador to IIM. It's my job to promote. There is some fellowship called Marie Curie and people are eligible to apply, and more people should apply. The Marie Curie program is because it's user friendly. Then that another one is Marie Curie Alumni Association, because after the Marie Curie program, these Alumni Association, I am a lifetime member. So we were using this alumni every year. They used to make a call to attend a conference. Like if you want to go outside the India or inside the India, they do give. Like if it is outside India, I think they used to give 800 euros, and if it is inside India, 400 euros per conference. You have to show all tickets and other things. You need to submit a proposal to get the fund. So in this way, after my Marie Curie, like 2012, I completed my Marie Curie, but till now, I think 4 to 5 times I got funded a travel bursary grant from Marie Curie Alumni Association. So I should be grateful. Like, you know, they're not leaving you in the middle. Once you finish Marie Curie, so you don't have, no, we do have a, you know, support system in the European Union that was funded because we need to pay some 200 euros as a lifetime member. I think they're doing it well enough. And they have a system every year they advertise, like, you know, if students, if you don't have a fund, if you are a Marie Curie fellow, you are eligible to apply, then they don't give for everybody. They do see your proposal, how far it's going to benefit you, society, environment, though they get funded. So I think 6 to 7 times in 8 years, I got the fund. I attended many Indian international conferences and international as well. So these are the most of the funding resources I used so far. And I think this is what national and international level funding resources I got so far. Now I think I'm going to share a bit of microencapsulation or membrane technique for loading, whether it's a chemical component or chelating agent or your drug molecule or antioxidants or enzyme or bacteria, irrespective of the material. Something I'm going to encapsulate using my membrane technology. I think this is a piece of work funded by my Marie Curie. It was quite 8 years old work, but still I published. So I wanted to show, because I think this stand bio, I guess, is more of interdisciplinary people. They are working on biochemistry aspect. So this title I have chosen is more to do with encapsulation. The encapsulant may be of any source, chemical, biological, whatsoever. The technique I'm going to show is membrane technology to make a uniform, smooth microspheres for variety of applications. So let's see the real topic that I'm going to discuss. So this is my outline. Like anywhere, if I'm fast, if you feel or if you're not able to see the slides, you can very well pass me, whoever is the organizer. Okay, the basic outline I'm going to discuss is like, you know, what is microspheres? What is polymer microspheres? How to prepare it actually? What are the techniques we use generally? Phase inversion and membrane emulsification. And once you make, when you are fabricating the microsphere, the factors influence the microspheres, and the factors is directly affect the characterization, how the microsphere looks like, how it behaves. Because whatever you are encapsulating inside the microspheres has to leach out in a controlled manner, whether it's a delayed drug delivery or controlled drug delivery or targeted drug delivery. Maybe they use some physical forces, maybe it's a pressure or maybe your intestine conditions. This microsphere has to break and it has to release the material in a certain way that should be controlled. So if it is a targeted drug delivery, you need to make a microspheres where the morphology is very crucial. Morphology is like, you know, the material, whether it looks porous or non-porous or dense or maybe spongy or channel. These are the technical terms they use when you say morphology, because you have a microspheres, that microsphere surface is very dense. Means you don't have any pores. If that is the case, whatever you load in the inside the microspheres of no use for you, because you simply store it. But in time to time, you need to take the material out. You need to get the material out in a controlled way. So that is very important to design. When you are designing, you need to know the final application, whether I'm going to use it for drug delivery or I'm going to use it as a load some flavonoids for some fruit nutrients, or I'm going to load some volatile compounds that can be used in the perfume industry, or I'm going to use some chelating agents in the microspheres that may be useful for your pollution control, whether it's a metal removal or dye removal or organic component removal. It depends. So before designing your microsphere, you need to know, yeah, what is my final application? I want this application. So it's like a tailor-made process. Generally, membrane technique, they always say it's a tailor-made process, because it's like you are going to a tailor shop and you will design your top. Like whether I want full sleeve, I want half sleeve, I want with collar or without collar, I want a white color button or green color button or fancy button, or I want elastic, everything. It's up to you to decide. So I have to decide what I want. That's why they call it as a tailor-made process. The membrane technique, they call it as tailor-made, because everything we can assign, we can plan, we do pre-plan everything to get the membrane. Similarly, the microspheres also, we have to do all pre-calculation and designs and the execution process, so you don't end up in wasting your time or chemicals or somebody's money on, you don't lose your peace of mind, because you are planning in a such a way that sure, 100% you are sure that you will get the product. It's not like that 50-50. No, we will never do like that. Before going to the lab, we are very sure, yeah, we get the product. Evening, yeah, we come out with the product, and accordingly, we do book the instrumentation analysis, whether it's IR or SEM or AFM or TEM, whatsoever, porometer, bet analysis, everything we pre-book in the sense that, yeah, we will get the product. So if you want to get the product, you have to do the planning in a such a way. After taking a reference, literature reference, make sure nobody worked on the area and what are the disadvantages already existing in the area, how you will rectify it. These are the common pre-planning you are supposed to do to make sure you get product 100%. Maybe some hiccups, maybe one or two microparticle, maybe not in a shape, that doesn't matter. But you have to give analysis. You have to do the characterization within 2-3 days. That means you should have a confidence that, yeah, I get the product. So these are all very crucial factors to design a microsphere. Especially if it is a polymer microsphere, we have to be very sure what kind of polymer I'm using, whether it is synthetic polymer or natural polymer. If it is synthetic, my conditions are different. If it is natural polymer, the conditions are different, because the difference between synthetic and natural is synthetic polymers, almost everything is hydrophobic in nature. Even a small amount of exposure to the water vapor can, end your lifetime of your synthetic polymers. It will be like coagulator. It is of no use. Whereas in the case of natural, or they call it as a biopolymer, these biopolymers are generally originated from biological sources, or it is completely degradable. These two parameters need to be followed so that you can call some polymers as a natural or biopolymers. So these biopolymers in general, all are water soluble. All are polyvinyl alcohol, ketosine. Of course, we have to use a little bit of acetic acid, 2-8%, carrageenan, alvin, all polysaccharide, marine seaweed polysaccharide, everything is water soluble. So one synthetic is completely hydrophobic in nature, another one is hydrophilic in nature. So this is what I said, you have to know what's your end application, what's your final plan before you choose your experimental condition and the material. The next factor is the solvent. Like I said, solvent, when you make a polymer solution, you have to be 100% sure that you completely dissolve the polymer particle. And the second factor is, once you prepare the solution, you can't use it immediately, because though you are using a magnetic stirrer and heat, maybe in 4 hours you get the solution, but the solution looks clear, but there will be a lot of micro bubbles that you may not see through your normal eyes. So generally you prepare a solution, leave it overnight or at least 5 hours in the humidifier, or people do use, you know, gasification, degasification. Because if there are some micro bubbles in your solution, then you are making a microspheres or membranes. Whatever the final product you are getting will have a lot of pinholes that may not be visible to you, but when you do scanning electron microscope, you will clearly see that you are spoiling your material mechanical stability just because a lot of micro bubbles are there. So the solution preparation is like, you know, so meticulous process. You have to take the polymer, you have to dry the polymer in the oven to make sure there is no moisture if it is for synthetic polymer. But if it is a natural or biopolymer also, you have to dry it in the oven, make sure it doesn't have too much moisture. But when you have to make the solution, you need to have a setup like, you know, proper temperature control stirrer. And after, when the solution is ready also, you have to keep it in the fume mode in ambient condition, ambient relative humidity condition, so that the micro bubbles, mini bubbles whatsoever, there will be a lot of air bubbles because it's like stirring. So it will create a lot of bubbles. So that bubbles has to be eliminated. Then you will say your solution is ready. Generally, we allow overnight to in the lab ambient condition. Once you prepare solution, now tomorrow only we will be able to make the microspheres. The solvent, like I said, for the synthetic polymers, we always go for solvents of synthetic origin, like hydrocarbon solvents. It may be dimethylformamide, N-methylpyrrolidone, dimethyl sulfoxide, or tetrahydrofuran. These four are like, you know, it's like common. These four solvents, they use it for everywhere. If it is membrane or microsphere, if it is related to synthetic. But whereas in the case of biopolymer, most of the cases is like water. And in some cases, you have to apply a little bit of heat, because normal 40, it may not dissolve. Whereas in the case of polyvinyl alcohol, the molecular weight increases, you need to give higher temperature. So temperature plus water is enough to that. The next factor is concentration. Whether will be able to make a microsphere with any concentration of polymer, like 1-8%, 2-8%, no. We need to optimize that. Generally, I think in school also we study the phase diagram, the triangular figure, where you have three phases at one case. They call it as a critical point. So what we do, we take the polymer, we make the solution. And in the case of like polyether sulfone, consider I'm taking a synthetic polymer, polyether sulfone, it's hydrophobic in nature. I take 10-8% of polymer, I have a clear solution, there is no micro bubble, I made sure that, then I took the solution, I take it in a small beaker, I take like 2 ml, I do the weight, microbalance, like a proper sensitive microbalance I should use to get the 4 decimal values. Then I will add, because the solvent for polyether sulfone is dimethylformamide. So the phase diagram, how to construct, we have to add solvent, non-solvent, solvent, non-solvent. So when you're adding a solvent, you get the clear solution. And when you add a non-solvent, here the non-solvent is water. Because synthetic polymers are hydrophobic in nature, and the one drop, even the water vapor, can coagulate your synthetic polymer. So water is my non-solvent. I take like 2 grams of my polymer solution in a beaker, then I add 1 or 2 drops of water. Immediately I can see the turbidity in my solution. That means its polymer is coagulated. So I have to take the weight. So I know the initial weight, I know the weight. I have to keep on doing that. So how to remove the turbidity? I have to add again one or two drops of solvent, that is dimethylformamide, to make sure my solution is homogeneous again. Because when you add the solvent, again the coagulated polymer will be again redisposed. You get the homogeneous solution. So now I have to take the weight. So I have three weights. Again, I will add water as a non-solvent. So like that, you have to do, it's like a long process. At least you need to get 50. At least you need to get 50 weight differences. Then you have to plot it in the graph. Then you get the triangular plot. And at one particular condition, let's say 12.58% of the polymer and this water and the non-solvent, everything is miscible. That is the critical point we choose. That means 12.58% of the polymer and 82.58% of the solvent. So these kind of information we get from the phase diagram. From that, we optimize, yeah. For each polymer molecular weight, these values are different. Every polymer has a different. So we can't unilaterally say, yeah, every polymer I make microsphere with 10 weight percentage. No, impossible. Because the polymer density, viscosity of the solution, viscosity of the solvent, everything is crucial to get your proper microsphere. So first you have to do the phase diagram. Then you construct the phase diagram. You will understand what is the optimum concentration to make the microsphere. So for this, polymer concentration, solvent, and the real concentration are crucial. Like I said, application, this microspheres has various application, right? From direct delivery to the synthetic, the sensors. Now we have a food package. No, it's not like a normal food package.
Ma'am, right? Ma'am, one second, ma'am. You change the slide, ma'am. I think the outline slide is only, yeah.
No, I'm just talking. No, I'm just talking about outline only. Now.
Okay, ma'am. Sorry to interrupt, ma'am.
It's okay. So now we have clear idea that why we need microsphere, how to prepare microsphere, and what are the main applications. Like I said, we have to use for drug delivery, and we can use this microsphere for the active package. Active package in the sense, if you have a kiwi fruits or if you have some perishable fruits. So what they do, they know when they have to remove the fruits, but in some cases they need to travel like 500 kilometers to reach the main city. Imagine we have some fruits from Thanjavur, it has to reach the Chennai for us market. So we know the ripening time. So we have to remove the fruits. We have to do it in a package. That package is like a transparent package, is like a normal polythene, but this transparent package inside was loaded with polymer microspheres. So what this microspheres will do, it will slowly control the acetylene, whatever the gas coming from the fruit, so that it will not ripe very fast, so that we can hold till 2 days or maybe one night. It can travel to Chennai to reach the supermarket. Then also something happens. So generally what people do, they do activated carbon loaded microsphere. That microsphere, they load it in the food package. Then you can see the color change. If the food is not, like your fruit has damaged or it's more gas emitted, so something problem, from the color change, you can understand, yeah, you can't sell that. So the applications are like, wide, very much wide. So drug delivery to active packaging to many more applications. So how people are working on micro encapsulation or microsphere preparation, so forth. Like I said, there are two materials. Whatever you are going to encapsulate inside the microsphere, it's like guest. Like I'm coming to Tanvi. Tanvi, I am a guest. Tanvi is my host. So the compatibility between host and guest is very important to maintain the homogeneity. So in the case, the host is my polymer, whatever it is, synthetic or bio, the guest may be of anything. It may be solid or liquid or gas whatsoever. So the compatibility is important to make sure we are able to make the microsphere. I think according to the literature, the first one, whatever they have this encapsulated material, it was 1950. And the picture clearly shows, it's like, imagine like a ball, that is your polymer microsphere, and the skin or shell layer, that is very important, whatever you want to release. So how they are doing in the encapsulation so far, there are two different, technique. One is a physical process, another is a chemical process. Chemical process, I think everybody is much aware. They do, polymerization, or maybe it's something means they are taking two polymer, they're trying to do it in a such a way they develop a condition. So there will be kind of chemical interaction between that, then you end up in getting a polymer microspheres. Another parameter is the physical process or mechanics. That means we are not doing any chemical reaction. Imagine, I take a guest, I have a A and B is my encapsulated guest. I take these two, I change the experimental condition, the physical forces like temperature or mechanical force or the evaporation condition or stirring speed. So I do something, I play with these, the physical parameters, and try to make the polymer microspheres. I am more interested in the physical process than chemical process. The physical process advantage is you are very sure whatever you are loading inside your microspheres is inert in nature. Whereas in the case of the chemical, probably the two chemical polymers, the monomers you are taking, you are doing the polymerization reaction, you may end up in getting the polymer microspheres. That application may be for another thing. But in my case, whatever I am loading, I want the loaded material should be inert. Whenever I break the microsphere, I should get my material back in an inert condition. Whatever the condition I loaded, I should get back. That means the host should be like inert, just like a shield. It's like a shield inside my, imagine like egg, we have white, we have yellow. Yellow is intact. There is no chemical or physical interaction, but still it's inside. So this is what my plan or people believe in doing encapsulation. I choose the mechanical or physical process, and I choose probably the technique, like, you know, they use the pressure, they use some pressure with the pressure extrusion method, and this phase inversion falls into the pressure extrusion methods.